This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. And good evening. Welcome to our service of worship and praise as we celebrate the Festival of Thanksgiving. We're going to follow the order of service in your worship folder tonight, beginning with one of those old Thanksgiving hymns that we've come to cherish. We praise you, O God, our Redeemer, Creator. God bless your worship with us tonight. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, let us come before our holy God with sincere and repentant hearts and confess to him our many sins. Lord God, my heavenly Father, I acknowledge and confess to you that at times I receive your many blessings without giving thanks to you. I expect you to bless me, and when you withhold anything from me, or you allow trouble and hardship to come, I complain, I doubt your love, and I become critical of you. Dear Lord, forgive me. Forgive me for not giving you thanks in all circumstances. Cleanse me from all my sins and take away the guilt they have left on my heart. Have mercy on me and grant forgiveness according to your unfailing love. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in love. He will not accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. Because God so loved the world and sent his Son who lived and died and rose again for you, be assured that this God has made you his dear child through faith in Jesus and declares you an heir of eternal life. Be at peace. Your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And let us pray. Almighty God, our Father, your generous goodness comes to us new every day. By the work of your Spirit, lead us to acknowledge your goodness, give thanks for your benefits, and serve you in willing obedience. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. Tonight's first reading, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 8 through 11. God's grace results in our righteousness and thanksgiving. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. As it is written, he has scattered abroad the gifts to the poor. His righteousness endures forever. Now, he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will also supply and increase your store of seed and will enlarge the harvest of your righteousness. You will be made rich in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. This is the word of our Lord. Blessed are they who hear God's word and live by it. Amen. And for our gospel reading, we turn to the traditional gospel for Thanksgiving, Luke chapter 17, beginning with verse 11. Which one was truly thankful? Now, on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance and called out in a loud voice, "Jesus, Master, have pity on us." When he saw them, he said, "Go, show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw he was healed, came back praising God in a loud voice. He threw himself at Jesus' feet and he thanked him, and he was a Samaritan. Jesus asked, "Were not all 10 cleansed? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Rise and go. Your faith has made you well." This is the gospel of our Lord. Our next hymn is, "O Bless the Lord, My Soul." Thank you. To the immortal, invisible, only wise God be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. We just mentioned Moses in that last hymn. For our devotion this evening, we turn to the words of Moses, and they are recorded for us in Deuteronomy chapter 8, beginning with verse 6. Observe the commands of the Lord your God, walking in obedience to him and revering him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with brooks, streams, and deep springs gushing out into the valleys and hills, a land with wheat and barley, vines and fig trees, pomegranates, olive oil, and honey. A land where bread will not be scarce and you will lack nothing. A land where the rocks are iron and you can dig copper out of the hills. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land that he has given you. And these are the words of our Lord. And in Jesus' name, who is the giver of every good and perfect gift, especially the gift of his love and forgiveness. My dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I've said it many times before, and I'm going to say it again tonight. We Americans, generally speaking, are lacking in gratitude. Wouldn't you say that's true? In our nation, the poor and those of moderate income often envy those who are rich, never realizing or recognizing just how wealthy they really are. In our country, just about everybody considers themselves an oppressed victim of some sort, never recognizing or appreciating all the wonderful freedoms that we enjoy in this land. There are so many Americans these days that think that people in other countries have it better than we do, when really it's those countries that envy us. And I've said it this before, and I'll say it again. This attitude of ingratitude can so easily rub off even on us Christians. I mean, when we are living day in and day out among people who are lacking gratitude, it's really easy for us to lack gratitude too. And that's why this festival of Thanksgiving is so very important to us. It's a great corrective to that awful attitude. And so this Thanksgiving, keeping in mind God's word before us, let's be sure to, as our theme says, thank God for our good land. And here's what we'll talk about tonight. That we have earned a difficult life, but God has favored us richly, and therefore we want to praise and obey the Lord. So, God's word to us tonight from Deuteronomy takes place around the year 1406 BC. The 600,000 families of the Israelites are about to enter the promised land, the land God had promised them for generations and generations. And their old leader, Moses, is addressing the Israelites for the last time before he dies. And these Israelites have gone through a really difficult journey. And it was so difficult, mostly because of their own sins. It was difficult on account of their own transgressions. They had wandered in the desert for 40 years. They had eaten basically nothing but bread down from heaven for 40 years. During those 40 years, almost all the adult Israelites died, so that by the time of our text, there was only just a couple of people left who were over 60 years old. And why was this happening? Again, as I said, because of their sin. They grumbled and they complained against God and against Moses every step of the way. They constantly were doubting God. And even after God had slain the firstborn among the Egyptians, even after God had drowned Pharaoh's army in the depths of the sea, even after God had been leading them in a pillar of fire by night and a pillar of cloud by day, even after all of that, they doubted that God could deliver them to the promised land. That God could not do that for them. And so God made them wander for 40 years. 40 years. That's from 1982 until now. And I think that you and I can relate to these Old Testament Israelites in this sense. Think of the difficult, awful, miserable journey that our ancestors went through many, many years ago. You and I today, we probably would not have survived. Most of them had to travel by boat across the sea for many weeks. And then when they landed here in America, they had to ride slowly or probably walk about 1,000 miles halfway across the U.S. And then when they got here, they probably bordered with relatives, and they worked as day laborers from sunup till sundown until they could afford a farm of their own. And then the real work began, the work of clearing their property of trees and removing all the stones by hand and planting crops and acquiring animals and all the while trying to raise and feed a family of their own. They burned during the hot summer days. They froze during the cold winter nights. How many of them died from childhood diseases? How many of them died from adult-related accidents? And I mention all of this because this difficult and miserable life is something we have earned. And we have deserved on account of our sin. We are the sin-inclined children of those flawed ancestors of ours. It's our backs that ought to be bent. It is our knees that ought to be crushed under the weight of our sins in hell forever. But God has a better ending for us, just like he had a better ending for those Israelites. Let's read about that. Here's where our text says. Moses said to the people, "The Lord your God is bringing you into a good land." And just listen to how good a land this is. A land with brooks and streams and deep springs gushing out into the valleys and hills. And for a people who had been wandering in a dry desert for 40 years, boy, this must have sounded like paradise to them. All that water. And furthermore, it was a land with wheat and barley. And by the way, those are the two chief grains in the land of Israel, and they are harvested at different times of the year, so there would be grains for them throughout the whole year. And besides those grains, there were vines, grapevines, fig trees, and pomegranates. And again, I don't know if you knew this, but those are fruits that become ripe at different parts of the year, so they would have fruit all year long. Plus, it was a land of olive oil and honey. The honey was just an outright sweet, sweet blessing from God. But the olive oil, that was absolutely essential for cooking, for seasoning, for salves, for lighting at night, so they would have light. In the end, this was a land where bread would not be scarce and you will lack nothing. This promised land was a land where the rocks are iron and you can dig copper out of the hills. So both iron, strong iron, and flexible, useful copper were present in this land. With a little bit of work, these Israelites would have all the metal they needed. And as you heard the description of this promised land that God was bringing his people to, for them it must have been too good to be true. It must have been heaven on earth. And you know whose land it sounds like an awful lot? It sounds like our land, doesn't it? Only we have it even better. I mean, who lives in the lands of 10,000 lakes? And we should never underestimate that blessing. Just ask those folks in the United States who are constantly being threatened by wildfires out west or drought down in the south. Ask them if they would like our water supply. They would tell you yes, for sure. We probably spill more water over the course of one day than a lot of people around this world use in one day. And that's nothing compared to this. Who has been bathed in the sweet, sweet waters of holy baptism? Who has had their sins washed away in the ocean of God's mercy? Who has been submerged in the forgiveness of Christ in baptism? You have. I have. We've enjoyed those waters. What a reason for us to be thankful tonight. And then, how about this? Who can stroll into a great big supermarket that is stocked from floor to ceiling with all kinds of fruits and grains and vegetables and Pop-Tarts and cheese and milk and any cut of meat, delicious meat that you'd want to sink your teeth into? The ancient Israelites didn't have that. Most people around the world don't have that. We've got it in abundance, so much that we basically take it for granted. And even more, how about this? Who of us has had on our own lips, in our own mouth, deep down in our own soul, the very body of Christ in Holy Communion? That kind of food. The body of Christ that burst open the tomb for us. The blood of Christ, which seeped from his wounds for our salvation. We've had that in Holy Communion. Boy, what reason do we have to be thankful for all such blessings like that? Or how about this? Who has had not just iron and copper like those ancient Israelites, but who has access to steel and platinum and aluminum and all kinds of plastics and all kinds of silicon chips that are able to process what? 3.6 billion bits of information per second. And you line up all those silicon chips in a device no bigger than the palm of your hand, and right away you have access to the sum total of all the wisdom that's out there on the internet. Plus, you can use that same device to communicate with people across this planet. But we've got even more than that. We've got real wisdom. Not internet wisdom, wisdom from God. We have the wisdom of knowing that God sent his Son to live a perfect life for us. And since he was true God himself, he could make that perfect life count for a whole world full of sinners. And we have the wisdom of knowing that God sent his Son to die on the cross to pay for every one of our sins, past, present, and future, so that they are gone forever. We've been given that wisdom of knowing that Christ Jesus rose from the dead to guarantee our life everlasting and a blessed reunion with those that we know who have died in Christ. We have that wisdom, and we have communication too. When we cry out to God for forgiveness, He hears us. When we cry out to God for rescue, He listens to us. When we cry out to God for answers to our prayers, He always answers them for our good. What reasons we have to be thankful this evening. Now, it's true then that we have deserved a difficult life on account of our sins, but God has blessed us richly and favored us greatly, chiefly with the abundance of His forgiveness and His promise of paradise. And my friends, we just have to respond to that. We just have to. And how do we go about responding to it? Well, in our text for tonight, the Lord urged His people to respond too in two ways. He wanted them to praise, and He wanted them to obey. He wanted them to praise. This comes at the end of our text. When you've eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land He has given you. And He wanted them to respond with their obedience too. And that comes at the first part of our text. He says, observe the commands of the Lord your God, walking in obedience to Him and revering Him. And for us too, this is how we respond to God's blessings. We praise and we obey. So let's praise Him. For the rest of this service, let's speak nice and loudly. For the rest of this service, let's sing nice and loudly. Loudly enough that if we could open up these windows, everybody would hear us who's traveling up and down the streets in the front of our church and the back of our church. I mean, shouldn't we speak about Christ as loudly as we speak about politics or football, or our kids, or our grandkids? Shouldn't we sing about Christ as loudly as we sing to ourselves in the shower or sing with our kids in the car? Shouldn't we talk about Christ just as naturally as we talk every day about the weather? Yeah, let's praise Him like that. And then let's obey Him too. Let's say that you're a worker. You're going to go back to work tomorrow or maybe Monday. Keep the commands of the Lord your God. Revere His name. Walk in His ways. Get to work on time with a smile on your face. After all, the work you do is what God wants you to do so that you can serve other people. And then put in an honest day's work without any time wasting or dawdling. And be happy to serve the people around you at work. Work as if you're working for Jesus Himself, because really, you are. Remembering in all of it, all the blessings that you are thankful for. Or let's say that you are a student, and there's a number of them here tonight. As a student, you got to go back to school on Monday. Walk in the ways of the Lord. Get a good night's sleep the night before. Wake up with some gratitude in your heart. Get to your classes on time. Appreciate your teachers. Every one of them, in all sorts of different ways. Appreciate all of your fellow students, every one of them, in any way that you can. And in it all, remembering all that you have to be thankful for. Or let's say you're not a worker or you're not a student, but you're a stay-at-home mom or a stay-at-home dad. You know, be glad in the service that God has given you to do in your home. Walk in His ways. Take pride in your home. It's a great gift from God. Take pride in serving your family. They're a great gift from God. And if you don't have as many responsibilities now as you used to, maybe find ways to help others who have more responsibilities. At the very least, pray for them. So, I started off the sermon by saying that generally speaking, we Americans are lacking in gratitude. And it's true. Nevertheless, we are one of the few countries in the world that sets aside a national day of Thanksgiving. And no one celebrates like Thanksgiving like we Americans do. And especially as Christian Americans, we've got something to be thankful for. We have Jesus. So be cheery continually. Treat every day like it's Thanksgiving Day. And let others know tomorrow and the next day and the next why you're so cheery. Because you have Christ. Amen. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. At this time, we present our offerings to the Lord. Please rise for our responsive prayers. We pray. Lord of heaven and earth, you made all things well. By your mighty hand, you have created the heavens, the earth, the seas, and all that is in them. You provide all that we need and more, food and drink, clothing and shelter, homes and families, spouses and children, transportation, work, and a good income.
Thank you, Lord, for your tender care.
Father in heaven, you preserve and protect us daily. You provide farmers to harvest food, police to provide security, soldiers to secure liberty, leaders and government to ensure peace and justice.
Bless and preserve these men and women
who serve us faithfully. Almighty God, you daily protect us with your angels. Use them to guard and protect us from danger and deliver us from every evil attack. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for his coming to us in word and sacraments, for his giving and forgiving, and for his sake hearing us as we pray, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Lord God, all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works come from you. Give to us, your servants, that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments. Defend us also from the fear of our enemies, that we may live in peace and quietness. Through the merits of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. You may be seated for our final hymn. Good evening. And thanks for joining us either as a member or as a visitor here for our Thanksgiving Eve service. It is a true pleasure to bring you the good news about your Savior and to remind you of all the blessings that we have through him. One of those great blessings that we never take for granted is the access we have to his word. And with that in mind, I do want to remind you that the new meditation booklets are here, where you can be daily in God's Word. They're set out on the counter, and I think we're looking for a donation of $4 or $5 just to cover the costs of these. Then there are other devotional books. One is My Devotions. These are for kids and their families, grades maybe or maybe third grade all the way up to eighth grade or so. There's a limited number of those. If you want one of those, pick up one of those for your family tonight. And then, as they've done every other year, Martin Luther College, our pastor and teacher training college, puts out a series of Advent devotions. And there's a bunch of these little booklets for your family to use for their Advent devotion time. They begin not on the first Sunday of Advent, November 27th, but they begin December 1st. If you would like one of these booklets, we've got plenty of those too. If we run out, we have some more in the office. That is our announcements for this evening. I look forward to greeting you in the entryway and pray that you have a very happy and enjoyable Thanksgiving, especially if you're with family, and a safe one too if you're going to be traveling any distance. Thank you.